This week at the Internet Cafe, writers on the web. Meet Brendan Kehoe, author of Zen and the Art of the Internet. What's a cyberpunk? Read the fake book and even you could pass for one. This is Are You Sirius, famed cyberpunk writer and co-founder of Mondo 2000. We'll show you the Net Chick Clubhouse, a cool website featuring women writers, plus a program that helps you become a good writer, and free software to organize your books, solve a crossword puzzle, or create a crossword puzzle, and a brand new word game, all coming up on our Cyber Blast, Writers on the Web, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet here with Andrew deVries and Jane Wither. We're at CyberSmith in Palo Alto as usual, and we're talking about writers on the net, both writers who write about the net and writers who write on the net. And somebody asked me an interesting question a couple days ago. I'd like to see what your answer would be. The guy said to me, do you think the Internet revolution, from a writer's point of view, is more important than the printing press? And I said, I think in a way it is, because while the printing press made it easier to disseminate information, the net not only makes it easier to get information out there, but it gets the information coming back, so it's the two-way thing. I think potentially it's more revolutionary from a writer's point of view. Would you agree?
Well, I think the interactivity with the web is really key. But I think from a writer's perspective, what's more important is the ability to actually write your novel and post it on the web so anybody could view
it. Same old issue of access, you don't have to wait for the publisher,
right.
The agent, all that
no
stuff.
No editing, it's just the way you wanted it to be. So I think that's probably the most exciting thing about having the web.
Well, you know, my question really is anybody going to read it? There's a wealth of information on the Internet right now, but, you know, I like to go home and curl up with a nice book, and it's hard
not
to do
a monitor?
When it's attached to a 17-inch monitor, yeah.
So you don't want to read Shakespeare on a screen?
Print
it out, that's all.
Well, then you're back to print again.
You're right, okay. We'll talk about writers, and we'll meet some writers on the net tonight at the Internet Cafe.
Yeah. So, Brendan, tell me a little bit about what the Zen and the Art of the Internet is all about.
It was actually the first beginner's guide to the Internet that was written for people who aren't necessarily Internet or even computer experts. When I was in college back in Pennsylvania, we'd just gotten wired up, and no one really understood any of it. And as I learned more and more about it, people saw me and thought, oh, maybe I'll just ask him a question.
You became the expert.
Right. And over time, it was the same question over and over. How do I do this with email? How do I do that? So I realized it'd probably save me some time if I actually wrote all this down. So I would hash it out a little bit, and I realized I wanted to present it in a way that didn't assume someone had a certain level of expertise. They weren't techno wizards that could go and answer anything about a computer. So I go and I work this up, and then I was passing it around at the school, and I realized others are probably going through exactly what I was. So I put a copy out on the net back in early 1992.
There wasn't that much on the web,
The web didn't exist. The net wasn't as extensive as it is now. There were things that have now hushed down, like Archie and Gopher, other tools that many people don't even recognize by name. Just
so much
has
changed.
There.
Yeah, exactly. Since 5 years ago. So that's. So, I mean, basically, what you've done is you posted this book essentially on the web.
Right.
Do many other authors do that?
Not very many. Others like Bruce Sterling, who did the Hacker Crackdown, have also done it. But they found that there are some trade-offs in terms of being able to do it, because you don't get the money that you would from royalties from a book publisher. You do get the name recognition from the people who use the Internet. And I think what actually drove me to make sure that the first edition was then stayed on the net was the satisfaction of knowing that you've helped people.
Right, now, that you made a difference.
Right, every once in a while you'll hear from this person who says, this is my first email message, I learned how to do it from your book.
Thank you. That
makes your heart swell.
It does.
It makes it all worth it.
And the good news, I guess, from the perspective of the book, is now we're in the fourth edition in print.
Right.
So you've really taken it. I mean, from 5 years ago to today, so much has changed.
It changes repeatedly.
And it looks like you've integrated all of those changes into this book, but it's still very basic. It's a great introduction to the Internet. But now this leads me to another question, because we were talking earlier about children and the Internet, and the fact that for some of us who have kids, the big concern is giving your children access to Internet because of, you know, all of the hype about, you know, websites that you don't necessarily want them seeing. And I think that's probably what stimulated the next book, which is Children and the Internet. Tell me a little bit about what this is all about.
What brought that about was the number of people that are now using the Internet include families. Entire families now see it as the open door. They now see it as the perfect thing for children to do their homework, because that way the kids don't necessarily have to spend all their time at the library, although I sincerely encourage them to continue to go there. They can now surf the net and find very quickly some of the topics they might need for a paper or that sort of thing. But the danger with that is it's an adult medium, or originally was set up as such. So now we've got kids encountering things that parents don't necessarily want them to see, pictures that they don't want them to see, things they don't want them to read or learn about
yet. Racy websites.
Right,
yeah,
that sort of thing. So there are a whole bunch of packages that are available out now for that you can put on your computer and make it really easy for you to block that sort of thing.
So basically what that gives you is a list of sort of the websites you may not want to go to.
An initial set of things you probably don't want them to see, and many offer you the option to take things out or put them back in, so that way you can decide what you do want your kids to see or not see.
What I thought was interesting about this is it didn't assume that you had the software package. It also gives you hints if you're using AOL or other online services, how to maneuver your way around there to make sure that things go well. And I think the one thing I really liked when we were chatting earlier was the analogy that you used. I mean, when you talk about, you know, your kids playing in a playground, you generally make sure that there's somebody monitoring them.
Someone
so that nobody gets
them.
Hurt.
Right.
And the whole thing is the same thing with the internet. I mean, you really do need to monitor your children when they're surfing.
Right, it's a whole new horizon where now you've got your kids encountering things you don't necessarily want them to know about yet.
Right.
So you can't trust that they're going to know what not to look at. So instead, even if you yourself as a parent don't necessarily have the experience your kids do on the computer, which is often the case, you know, have kids who can
sometimes
blow their parents
away.
Sometimes
they're better than you are, exactly.
Right.
Yeah. So
you
this
can,
is
you can use it as
book.
A way. Right. You can use it as a way to give your kids the opportunity to teach you, if you want. But at the same time, you are there and you're able to see what they see, so you can catch things very quickly when they appear. And by using the software package, when something pops up to refuse you access, you can explain to your child what it means.
Exactly.
That it won't let you do that.
Well, this is exciting stuff, and I think there's a lot more information, not only for parents, but also for teachers in this book. So
right.
I think it's a pretty exciting prospect. And I think just the fact of having Zen and the art of the internet on a website so you can view it is also a great thing. Thanks very much for your time.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
You tired of the boys and their high-tech toys? I'm Virginia from Brillo Magazine, where we believe in low bandwidth, high content, and voices you don't normally hear inside the mainstream. So check it out for a chance to rant and rave about what bugs you on the World Wide Web. And don't worry, we're not nearly as angry as people tell you we are.
So we're here with St. Jude, and you've written a book called the Cyberpunk Handbook, or the Real Cyberpunk Fake Book.
It's real.
What is a fake book, and why a fake book?
A fake book is used by musicians to find their way through a song they don't really know, right? So this is about making it or faking it as a cyberpunk.
So I can basically read through this and learn
what. Oh, it's real stuff. It's real stuff. It's
that
just
I need to know.
Written like you wouldn't believe it.
That'll get
all.
Me going.
Yes.
So as far as becoming a cyberpunk, what is a cyberpunk?
A cyberpunk is, it's sort of like, it's less passé than Dada. And it's more interesting than goth.
And I did see some goth in there as well.
Goth is just
stuff.
Death warmed over, let's face it.
Okay. So it's a trend, but it's more than a trend. It takes some intelligence. You have to know what you're doing.
It takes a kind of a directed intelligence, focused wiliness, right? Especially if you're actually a hacker.
And hackers seem to be sort of the in vogue, if you will, of the cyberpunk.
nice to think.
Right. What is a hacker?
Okay. Hacker and cyberpunk are really two different things. A hacker is, I just got back from the hackers convention, and I gave them a definition, which they didn't have, and they accepted it. Okay.
A whole room full of hackers, that's pretty good.
Yeah, not bad.
Tough crowd.
Okay, art of a hack. A hack is the clever circumvention of imposed limits. And the limits are not necessarily imposed by authorities, like, you know, you're not allowed to do this. It's also maybe your thoughts about things. I can't do that because it's impossible. Well, I think I'll do that.
So in a sense, anybody can be a hacker. If you come up with a creative or a unique way to do something, you're in a sense hacking what was going on before that.
Exactly. It doesn't need to involve computers like this. This is a physical hack here, right here. This is me in a dark suit, dark tie, white shirt, okay? Government employee, all access, no questions, no escort, okay?
So, and you're hacking into whatever restricted area that you might not have been able to go into before.
Well, this is kind of a fashion hack, actually. It doesn't necessarily mean anything.
Right.
We went to the Goodwill and we got a black suit and a dark tie and a white shirt, and that's it.
And it worked, and that was a hack. Well, that's great.
Yeah.
Speaking of hackers, you have brought with you somebody, Malice, who is,
oh,
I think, a hacker,
right.
maybe sort of a stereotype of a hacker.
And a perfect cyberpunk.
And a perfect cyberpunk.
Ideal.
So tell me a little bit about what makes Malice such a perfect cyberpunk.
Well, first of all, mirror shades defines the style. You can do without mirror shades if your eyes are sufficiently intimidating, but mirror shades are good.
Almost right? sort of mimicking the computer monitor, if you will.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, right. You can stare on anybody in mirror shades, however timid you might be, okay? Challenging hairstyle.
It looks like a mohawk to me.
Yeah, that's definitely a mohawk. It's not a less hawk. Right? a less hawk you can comb down and kind of disguise,
so this is
look normal, right?
Right.
This is, oh yeah, we've got the chip. Now that doesn't actually do anything, but it's really intimidating. And you'll notice that he is faintly sneering.
Right.
Right? This is important.
That is to...
Think intimidation.
Okay.
Okay, right, right. He's got some chunky, vicious-looking jewelry on.
Right.
He's wearing dark, shiny clothes. Okay, cyberpunk style.
Very interesting. And I noticed he has facial hair, so I may actually have a chance to be part of this cyberpunk movement down the road. So if someone wanted to get involved with this and wanted to talk to you more, how would they go about getting hold of you?
Oh, well, I'm seeing Jude at will.com. And I was going to give his email address, but maybe I should give his Austrian email address. That's at is Austria.
Austria. It's hard to get a hold of these hackers. I see that.
Yes.
That's a pretty obscure email address. Well, thank you very much for coming down.
Thank you.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you four software programs designed for Word people. No, not people who use Microsoft Word, people who like to play with words. If you haven't seen these Cyber Blasts before, this is the actual computer data going through the TV signal and right into your computer. I'll explain a little bit later how you can set up your computer to receive the software. First of all, let's explain what we're downloading to you. The file you see coming down now is the Crossword Construction Kit from Insight Software Solutions. This is a program that lets you easily create your own crossword puzzles in all kinds of fun shapes. Next, we're sending you Crossword Mania. This is a Windows program that lets you solve crossword puzzles on your computer screen. The game comes with lots of pre-constructed puzzles, or you can make your own. It has a great 3D interface and a colorful toolbar. Now, if you are a book collector, you'll like the next program we're sending you. It's called Smart Tracker, and it's a database for keeping track of all those books you've bought. You can even program in books borrowed from the library, and it will remind you when the books are due. Finally, another cool Windows Word game called Word Wrestle. This is kind of like the game Boggle. Now, to download these files this fast, you do need a TV modem. If you don't have one, you can still get these files on our website. Total download time will be about 30 minutes if you have a 28.8 modem. If you need information on how the TV modem works or how to set it up, you can also get that on our website. Just go to pctv.com and click on the Internet Cafe or Cyber Blast buttons. The download time is just about finished. Have fun with your four new programs. And that wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson.
All right, now you've been writing about this techno culture for a long time, I think before maybe people knew there was such a thing. Actually, when did you do the Mondo 2000? When did that start?
We started Mondo 2000 in 1989, actually. And before that, we had a magazine called Reality Hackers that led into Mondo 2000. That started in 1987. So that's sort of when we helped to define the idea of cyber culture, the combination of cultural interests with computers, the idea of a digital revolution, etc.
And that sort of led to the cyberpunk notion in fiction and stuff, too?
Yeah, well, they were running in parallel to us. Some of the cyberpunks were working in the early 1980s, and we were really, in a sense, vaguely aware of them. We were more conscious of the hacker community and the people who are writing software and designing personal computers in Palo Alto.
When you started the magazine, I mean, Mondo 2000 and the predecessor, we'll just all call it Mondo 2000, I mean, what was the idea? What were you trying to do?
We were trying to let people know that the future was going to be made of technology, that the future was, in a sense, digital, that technology was a major issue in our lives. People were in denial about that at the time, and that it would be changing our culture and our lives. And we were very irreverent about it. It was all, you know, we were having a big fun with it.
Well, I want to ask you that part of it. I mean, you talk about the technology part, but you hear about the, you know, virtual sex and smart drugs.
Yeah.
I mean, what part does that play in all of this? Or is that just the fun of it?
We were trying to, we came out of the underground press, out of the psychedelic culture, out of rock and roll. We tried to lend a sense of freedom and wildness and color and just, you know,
so
we tried to throw a lot of, right, splash a lot of color on it, basically. And also the idea that this could be a revolutionary tool, that this could be a way of really changing society and changing culture in a way that would be democratizing and liberating and very anti-system.
Is it doing that, do you think?
No, I think, I mean, to a great extent. I mean, it's so ambiguous. I mean, it does and it doesn't. You know, I mean, it's very much co-opted by commercial interests.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that. One good example is Mondo 2000 versus Wired.
Right.
Now, you must have some thoughts about what happened with Wired versus what you guys started.
Oh, well, Wired is sort of the corporate version of Mondo 2000. Wired took Mondo 2000, combined it with Business Week, in a sense. So that there's this underlying cultural reportage in Wired that mimics, in a sense, what Mondo 2000 was about, and they'll cover subcultures, but the overarching theme in Wired is more about the mainline big computer corporations and the politicians and the philosophies associated.
Some people think it's weird to talk about calling Wired corporate, because, you know, in the really corporate world, that's still seen as, like, cool,
well, yeah, and the really corporate world is still suspicious of them,
as
witness the problem with the IPO and all of that.
I want to ask you briefly about writing on the web. I know you're back writing for Mondo 2000, in fact.
Yeah, right? I'm actually guest editing two issues, one that'll be out this winter.
Now, you're also writing on the web. I know you have the Web of Deceit site. You've got your Mutate project. Just tell me a little bit about what you're doing there.
Well, I have these two sites. Web of Deceit has a lot of my articles and that kind of thing on it. And
so that's your personal stuff.
Yeah, that's my personal stuff. The Mutate project is associated with the book that I have out. It's been out for about a year, called How to Mutate and Take Over the World. And that actually has a public forum on it. And we're presenting text according to various themes that were in the book. And we're just gearing up, actually. I got some young gremlins who are ready to make some trouble with the culture, you know, people 19, 20 years old, and we're just gearing up. And we report on themes. Culture wars is one theme. Prepare for world flip out, kind of apocalypse culture is another theme. There's nerd sex, and there's, I forget, but there's another one in there as well.
Okay.
So David, no pressure, but we consider you to be the expert on e-zines for the evening. So, I mean, and certainly it's appropriate given your credentials as a contributing editor to Boing Boing, a columnist for Wired magazine, and your latest success, which is Reality Check, the latest book that you've co-authored. So we definitely think you're in line for the job. So without getting into too many more details, can you give me some ideas on some of the key e-zines that you think are particularly cool?
Well, the first e-zine, sort of my favorite right now, is one called STEM, which is sort of, in a way, a Boing Boing kind of web zine. It's all about fringe culture. They have an issue about surveillance or about, you know, the secrets of Disneyland or things like that, and that's a lot of fun, STEM. There's another one I like that's sort of a different kind of zine. One of the things I like about the web is how anyone can post information, and when that happens, to get through the noise, you need sort of a filter. Editors act as a filter. So I like sites that are sort of guides to other websites. One of my favorites right now is Disinformation, which is sort of an end of the millennium guide to, you know, the fringes of reason on the web, with everything from, you know, strange new cults popping up to weird conspiracy theories to, you know, information about psychedelic gurus.
Or so the end of the world.
End of the world, yeah. Absolutely. So there's, you know, annotated and reviews of different sites on the web relating to these subjects. So that's a lot of fun. Another one I like is sort of another similar kind of guide with its own information as well, and it's the Remote Viewing Mind Control Web Index.
Oh, what's that all about?
Yeah, it's all about sort of the government's psychic spying and, you know, who's involved in that conspiracy and, you know, is it true or is it not true? Well, they spend a certain amount of money. How effective really is psychic spying? You know, so there's information about it and links to other sites and other people's information about remote viewing and psychic spying. That's a lot of fun. I'm also really into weird science, like Nikola Tesla and perpetual motion and, you know, Bucky Fuller. So there's a site called Anders Mad Scientist page, which is just links to other sites that are information about, you know, weird fringe science. You know, some of it may be, you know, too strange to believe, but some of it is actual, you know, true and strange science. So that's a lot of fun as well. Another set I like, if I can sort of plug my editor, Boing Boing, Carla Sinclair, is the Net Chick Clubhouse, which is based on her book Net Chick, which is a sort of a hangout for sassy modem girls.
I've never heard that expression before, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's a cool place.
So now, what would
a
sassy modem girl do?
Sassy modem girl hangs out online and does websites and same thing that
Sassy modem guy
does,
yeah.
But you know, they're all a bunch of riot nerds. So
that's great. So, you know, one of the neat things about all of these e-zines is the fact that, you know, you're not just posting information, but you have a lot of interactions as
Absolutely.
Well. So I can only imagine that a lot of these sites, just half of the discussions are probably the most interesting things that you'd find there.
Yeah, it's like a community that develops around, you know, a similar area of interest.
Thanks very much, David. This is great stuff. Cool sites.
It's been cool being here. Thanks.
All right, Andrew, you talked at the beginning about reading all these great books online. And what kinds of things can you read online?
Well, you know, I studied English in college, and I thought I'd gotten away from the classics, and now they're back. They're all over the internet. MIT has a great site that has all of the Greek and Roman classics. Plato,
full text,
Plato, Socrates, Homer, they're all there. You can go on, you can search them by topic, by author, and bring them down. MIT also has a William Shakespeare site, the complete works of William
Shakespeare. All the Shakespeare plays,
everything,
and sonnets and everything?
Sonnets, you can sort by tragedy, comedy, whatever you
That's
want,
great.
And find it there. If you want something a little more current, there's sites about the Beat Generation, about with Jack Kerouac
right.
and Ginsberg. There's even audio files. You can listen to the writers actually speaking their words live. So there's
all there on the web.
It's
now, if you want to write the great American
novel,
I have some software I want to suggest. There's a terrific program called Write Pro. This is guy Saul Stein, who's a best-selling author.
Oh,
he somehow gets inside your computer and holds your hand through the whole writing process, developing storylines and characters and conflict and all that stuff.
Gives away his secrets.
Really cool program if you want to write. Another thing I like is a CD-ROM called Opening Night. This is for playwrights. If you want to write a play, you not only write your play in here. It's kind of meant for kids, but adults will do it too. You write your play, and it comes with props and sets and actors. You can actually play out the play right there. So it's really cool if you want to write the great play.
An animated sequence.
Yeah, yeah. yeah. Two great pieces of software for serious writers.
Great.
So let's go look up Shakespeare, speaking of serious writers. Jay, now that you've met some of these people and heard what they have to say tonight, do you think, from what you talked about at the beginning of the program, how easy it is for people to get on the web and publish on the web and get anything they want out there, maybe we miss that editorial process, that sort of vetting of what's worth publishing?
Well, I think the editing is appropriate for magazines and for books. But when you talk about the web and the fact that the web is this interactive medium, and it really is a place for you to put any kind of information, I don't necessarily think it's appropriate to be doing editorializing at the web.
You know, what I did think was interesting was I'm still not sold on reading online, but when I looked at the William Shakespeare site, all of the old English words that a lot of them I didn't understand were hyperlinks that I could click on, and it would give me definitions as I was reading through it. And I thought that was something that you just
I'll tell you, I'm reading a book right now. It's a kind of hacker murder mystery. And I keep on coming across a character's name and thinking, now, where did I come across that character before? Where's your... And my finger goes out to hit the find or search button, and I really wish I were reading it on a CD-ROM or online so I could go find these references. So I think the conversion process is underway. We'll see you next week here at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. Connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor. Videotapes of the Internet Cafe are available for $24.95 each. To order your copy, call 1-800-916-PCTV. We'll help you stay on top of the rapidly changing world of computers and personal technology. Call today for your copy of this episode of the Internet Cafe or any of our other award-winning programs. When ordering, please ask for tapes by show number and title. That's 1-800-916-PCTV.